So today I wanted to start with a short rhyme, and you probably haven't heard this before because I made it up 2 weeks ago. This is the debut, and I'm pretty excited about it. I feel like I still need some work, but I ran out of time, so this is what I ended up with. If I go on like this, I know where it leads. God bless those stuck taking care of me. You didn't like that? Okay, so I still need some work, but you kind of get the idea. If I go on like this, whatever this is, I know where it leads. God bless those stuck taking care of me. So the other version of this I had was like a Mr. T version, but I don't know if everybody knows who that is anymore. And so it was gonna go like this. If I go on like this, I know where it leads. I pity the fool who's stuck taking care of me. That's pretty good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Wow, okay, so, yeah, so, no more, we can't do more. So the point is this, and we're gonna talk about it for the next few minutes, is we're gonna talk a little bit about this. So let me just start real broad. Don't answer out loud, this is just kind of to get us on the same page. Are you driving responsibly? I hope you're driving responsibly, right, you know? If you drink, I hope you're drinking responsibly. If you're eating, which you do eat, I hope you eat responsibly and you eat healthy and you're watching your diet and your weight and all this stuff. If you use credit cards, I hope you're paying off your credit cards, you're being responsible financially. If you're a student, I just met one of our students this morning. If you're a student, you got to study hard because your parents love you, but they want you to move on, you know, with your life. So you got to study hard. So I hope you're studying responsibly. We could go on and on with that kind of stuff. So to take it, you know, down a level, and don't answer out loud, no elbows or anything. Has anyone this week, or maybe in the last several weeks, has anyone, a friend or a family member confronted you about something that concerns them about you? They're concerned about something you're into. They're concerned about someone around you. They're concerned about somebody who's getting to you. They're concerned about a relationship. Or they're just concerned about something that you're into that seems to be taking too much of your time, too much of your devotion, and they feel like maybe this is not something that you should be into. If they're right, and here's kind of where we're going today, if they're right that you're into something that's sort of taking control of you, leading you in a direction maybe you shouldn't go, or somebody's leading you, if they're right and things spin out of your control, who's stuck taking care of you? If I go on like this, I know where it leads. God bless those stuck taking care of me. Who is going to take care of you or fill in the gaps if this thing that they're worried about or this thing that maybe you're worried about gets out of control? Who's stuck paying your bills? Who pays for rehab? Who's gonna help you raise that baby? And before you push back, okay? Before you push back, I've been doing this a long time, okay? Did you know 100% of people who end up with DUIs or addictions or go to rehab or a self-inflicted health issue, you know what a self-inflicted health issue is? The doctors told you, your wife's told you, your husband's told you, the mirror tells you, everybody tells you you need to work on this self-inflicted health issue. 100% of the people who dealt with any of those things said, won't happen to me. Won't happen to me. I know it happens to everybody. I know, honey. I know, I hear you. I know. It won't happen to me. Did you know that 100% of the time their irresponsibility became partially or entirely somebody else's responsibility? Because when they ended up where they knew it would lead, or somebody warned them where it would lead, then they had to turn to some people for help. Do you know lawyers are expensive? And it's not because lawyers, you know, are something wrong with lawyers, just the way the system works. Did you know rehab is very expensive? Did you know that moving back in with your parents is very embarrassing? Did you know that if you ignore your health and somebody ends up having to take care of you because of a self-inflicted health issue, it's so embarrassing. That's not a story you want to tell. I got this, you know. Everybody's got this until they don't. And who do they turn to for help when they don't? Here's something I've observed. Irresponsible people, often, not always, irresponsible people often surround themselves with irresponsible people. Something else I've observed. Irresponsible people never turn to the irresponsible people around them for help when their irresponsibility finally catches up with them. So here's a serious question. I'm serious about this, okay? And you're not, this is, if, you know, if somebody's been bugging you about something and you just kind of blew them off, this is gonna be hard for you to answer this question. But you should answer this question. Who will you expect? Who will you expect to rescue you when your irresponsibility catches up with you? Let's just say on the off chance, you're like, it's not gonna happen to me. I got this, I'm handling this. I can deal with her, I can deal with him. It's not gonna happen to me. I know I got a lot of debt, but you know, just on the off chance. I mean, let's say there's 5% chance that what they're warning you about is gonna transpire, that you're not gonna be an exception to the rule. On the off chance that this irresponsible behavior of yours catches up with you, on the off chance, who are you going to turn to for help? You should at least know in the back of your mind, whose future, I can say it a different way, whose future does your current irresponsible behavior potentially jeopardize? Here's why you should answer this question, because, look up here, you should let them know today. You should call them up and say, you know the thing, you know, on the off chance that you're right, on the off chance that, you know, this relationship, on the off chance that this does happen to me, on the off chance, I just want you to know that if things fall apart, I'm gonna be on your doorstep and I'm gonna expect you to use your resources to bail me out. I just want you to know that. Do you know why you should tell them that? Because that's the responsible thing to do. And who knows, one responsible decision may lead to another. You might become a responsible person. Right? You're adults, you know this. It's not just your life. It's not just your business. Irresponsible behavior ensures that your business becomes somebody else's business. Most likely, this is the kicker. Most likely it becomes the business of the people that are closest to you that you say you love the most, the very people that you currently refuse to listen to. Man, that's your future. Unless you decide to join this elite group of people that we're calling the responsibles. So today is part three of this four-part series where I'm inviting you into, and we're inviting each other into, to join this elite group of superheroes. Super citizens, super husbands and wives and moms and dads and high school students and middle school students and children, super people, men and women students who are taking responsibility for their lives, their past, their present, and as we're gonna talk about today, their futures. This elite group of people that understand that their irresponsibility eventually, there's no way around it, that their irresponsibility eventually becomes somebody else's responsibility. And these superheroes that we're calling the responsibles that you're invited to be a part of, the superhero responsibles, they're like, I'm not having any part of that. For my irresponsibility to land in somebody else's lap, that is an epic fail. I don't go there. I'm not having it. The responsibles clean up what they mess up. It's who they are. They're the best neighbors. They're the best friends. They're the best husbands and wives, the best students, the best parents. And you're invited to join that group. But to join that group, for us to join that group, requires that we ask and answer honestly, a really important question. And we don't ask it and answer it once, we ask it and answer it throughout our life, in every season of life, because in every season of life, the circumstances change. And the question is this, am I taking responsibility for my life? Am I taking responsibility for my life? The question isn't, am I a responsible person? You are a responsible person. You show up at work, you show up at school, you pay most of your bills. So, you know, if I were to try to accuse you of being an irresponsible person, you can point to many, many, many areas of your life where you are a responsible person. But our question is different. It's, are you taking responsibility for your life, your full responsibility for everything you're responsible for, your actions and reactions, your past obligations, and your future obligations? And as I said last time, this isn't a Christian question. This isn't a religious question. This isn't a Christian thing. This is just a thing. This is just a people thing. If you have no faith at all, or you come from a different religious tradition, here's what I know about you. You don't want your irresponsibility to become somebody else's responsibility. You don't want your mess to end up in somebody else's lap because that's, well, it's irresponsible and it's embarrassing. And you don't think of yourself as an irresponsible person. So this is an all skate. This is for all of us. But if you are a Christian or somebody who's seeking to learn how to be a Jesus follower, like we're doing this growing network of people all over the world that realize it's not just about what you believe, it's about what you do with what you believe. If you want to be that kind of Jesus follower, then this is super important because as Jesus followers, not only are we forbidden from becoming an unnecessary burden to someone, we're actually commanded to look for opportunities to do the opposite. Here's what the Apostle Paul wrote. I mean, this doesn't get much clearer than this. He said this. He said, carry each other's burdens. Because from time to time, we can't help but be a burden because things happen that aren't our fault, that we're not responsible for. And suddenly there's a need, and suddenly there's a bump, and suddenly there's a health thing that we're not responsible for. He said, hey, if you're a Jesus follower, I want you to be freed up, and I want you to have the margin to be able to carry other people's burdens. Implication, don't become a burden unnecessarily. Don't create a burden that somebody else has to carry. And then look what he says next. And this is one of these statements that kind of slips through the cracks that if you were raised in church, this probably wasn't front and center, but it should have been. Listen to what he says. He says, and in this way, in other words, by carrying other people's burdens, by having the margin to carry each other's burdens because you haven't created a burden somebody else has to carry. Look at this. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Now, everybody's heard of the Ten Commandments, the ten law, the big famous laws. This little phrase right here does not get the airplay it should, but this is front and center for all Jesus followers because the Apostle Paul coined this phrase. This was his phrase to reduce or to summarize Jesus' new command that he gave his disciples at the end of his ministry, where he said, a new command I give you. The Apostle Paul calls it the law of Christ. There's not 10, there's one. Jesus says, you are to love one another. You are to value one another as God through me has valued you. He said, you are to love one another as I, Jesus, have loved you. There's the golden rule and then there's the platinum rule. The law of Christ is the platinum rule. And we are to live our lives in such a way that we have the margin to help carry other people's burdens because we have not become a burden ourselves. And the reason he says in this way you fulfill the law of Christ, because it's what Jesus did. Jesus did not put a burden on you. He lifted a burden from you. And that's what Jesus followers do. That's why we take responsibility for our lives. It's what Jesus followers do. It's what responsible people do. And then later in the same passage, he kind of doubles down and he says this. He says, for each one should, he's talking to Christians. For each one of you that claim to be a Jesus follower, you should carry your own load. That is, you got to take responsibility for your own life, your own actions, your own inaction, your past, present, and future, instead of creating and not create a load for somebody else to carry. Now, last time we were together, we looked back and we asked the question, are you taking full responsibility for your past? Or is someone currently managing your mess from your past because you left a mess in their lap? And we talked about what to do if that's the case. And we were very clear last time, it's worth repeating, that yes, God forgives you of your sin and God forgives you for the messes you've created for yourself and others. Yes, God absolutely forgives. But Jesus was so clear about that. And he was so clear in saying, look, because your heavenly Father has forgiven you, it's all the more reason to clean up what you messed up. In other words, that forgiveness, God's forgiveness, does not release us from our responsibility for our past. It's just the opposite. That taking responsibility for our past, taking responsibility for the messes that we've created through our actions and inactions and overreaction is actually the appropriate response to God's forgiveness. It's evidence of this word we don't talk too much about. It's evidence of repentance, that you've turned around and you're moving in the opposite direction and you're embracing perhaps responsibility that in the past you've run from. It demonstrates that we've truly had an encounter and submitted to our do what's best for others King. So today, for the next few minutes, I want to talk specifically about your future. And there's good news and there's bad news. It really depends on you. There's good news and bad news. And the good news or the bad news is this. Your future is coming for you. It is. It's a freight train, and it's coming. And the older you get and the older we get, the faster that train seems to be moving, doesn't it? I tell people all the time, I'm like, I feel like I have 3 days. I have Christmas, then I have Easter, and then it's summer. And then it's Christmas, then it's Easter, and it's summer. And then it's Christmas. And sometimes I just feel like there's two, right? This is, my future's coming for me. Your future is coming to you. Look up here. Refusing to plan for or refusing to take responsibility for your future as much as you can predict it is actually planning to be a burden to someone else, perhaps someone you love. So, you have to leave early. Bottom line, don't plan to be a burden by being irresponsible and refusing to face the future that is coming for you. Instead, we get to do the opposite as Jesus followers. We're to plan to be a blessing to other people. We are to anticipate the future and make plans according to what we can anticipate about our own future that sets us up to be a blessing to people and not a burden. And the best way maybe to understand this is this. Your decisions, my decisions, your daily decisions, my daily decisions are like the steering wheel of our life. You are steering your life in a direction. And the direction you're steering your life in, that direction to some degree, not 100%, but that direction to some degree determines your destination. I call it the principle of the path. The principle of the path is direction, not intention, determines your destination. Direction, not intention. We get so easily confused because intention, my intent, your intent doesn't matter. Your intent and my intent does not steer our lives. It is our decisions, which is determined by our direction. Our direction, not intention, determines our destination. So you are currently steering yourself toward a destination financially, physically, as it relates to your health, right? You're steering your life in a direction emotionally, mentally, relationally, even spiritually. So regardless of your age and regardless of your season of life, this isn't just for 25-year-olds, regardless of your age, regardless of your season of life, we should all pause from time to time and ask this question. If this continues, where does it lead? If this continues, where does it lead? If this continues, where does it lead me? If this continues, where does it leave me? And if this continues, where does it leave the people around me? And then we should adjust accordingly. Are you taking responsibility for your future? Or are you laying a trap for future you? Now, you know what? Most of us have lived long enough to know what I mean, for somebody to lay a trap for their future self. Because you have known people or know people, and you watch them make bad decision after bad decision after bad decision, and then they ultimately ended up someplace they didn't want to be, and it's like they laid a trap for themselves. You could see it coming. They couldn't or wouldn't, but you could see it coming. So the question is, are you inadvertently, accidentally, or just out of, you're just too busy to think about it, laying a trap for future you? I don't want you to do that. You don't want you to do that. As we're about to see, your heavenly Father doesn't want you to do that. And he has shown us the way forward. Early on in our marriage, Sandra and I memorized a verse of scripture from Proverbs. And I've talked about it before. In fact, she's talked about it with our congregation before. So if you've heard this before, good. If not, I'm glad you're listening or watching or here today. Proverbs 27:12. We turned this verse into a prayer that we prayed consistently, night after night, week after week. When our kids were born, it's one of the first verses we taught our kids, even before they were probably old enough to be able to memorize scripture. We just started early because this was such a powerful principle. Here's what it said. I'm going to kind of pick it apart, and we're going to jump to the New Testament, then jump back to this for just a minute. But here's what the writer of Proverbs said. The prudent, that's the wise person. The prudent is the person that understands that life is connected, that today is going to impact tomorrow, and yesterday is part of the reason I am where I am today, that life is connected. The prudent see danger, or the translation we memorized from says, the prudent see danger coming. That is, they're looking ahead and it's like, uh-oh, here it comes. The prudent see danger coming, and they do something. They respond to what they see. The prudent see danger, and then they take refuge. I remember specifically one of our kids kept saying refuse. the prudency danger and take refuge. I'm like, nah, it's not refuge. That's different. Okay, refuge, right. But that's what responsible people do. They see something coming, they acknowledge it, they admit it, they don't deny it, and then they take appropriate action. They respond to or prepare for the inevitable. But there's another character that gets introduced because this is how the Proverbs work. The prudent see danger and take refuge. But the simple, now the simple are generally, in Old Testament language, were usually younger people, you know, no frontal lobe development yet. So they're just having a hard time seeing how life is connected, right? The simple, but what I've learned and what you've learned if you've lived long enough is you can be older and simple. That you can approach your life as if life isn't connected, that somehow it's going to work out and somehow there's not going to be consequences. And, you know, it's just, he says, the simple, the person that doesn't acknowledge that their lives are connected, that today impacts tomorrow, they just keep going. They see danger, they see the same danger. They see the same freight train. They see what's happened to other people. And somehow they just keep going. And here's how they excuse it. I've got this. Mom, I've got this. I appreciate you guys sitting me down to talk about this. And I realize your concern for me. And it means a lot you friends would, you know, have the courage to talk to me about this and confront me. But I got this. I've got this. Hey, look, I see what you're saying. And I don't think you're wrong, but I've got time. Okay, I'm in my 20s. I'm only 30 something. I've got time. I'll be fine. Just, hey, I appreciate it, but I'm good. I've got time. I got fine. Now, I'm fine. When I was preparing for this message, it occurred to me, there's actually a Christian version of this. We would call it Christianese. You know, it's kind of a Christian language that doesn't really reflect Christianity, but Christians, you know, sometimes we just say weird stuff, okay? And if you're not a Christian, you're like, what? And it's like, we don't even know what we mean. We just, you know, it's just kind of sometimes, and you know what the Christian version of I've got this, I've got time, it's gonna work out, it'll be fine. You know what the Christian version of this sounds like? I'm just trusting God. Now, the problem is, this is the end of the conversation. How do you say to somebody, well, you shouldn't be trusting God, you need to take responsibility for, it's like, this just shuts down the whole conversation, and there's usually, they get this, I'm just trusting God with this. I mean, even as the pastor, it's like, all right, well, conversation over, you just trust God with that. This oftentimes, you know, God's gonna work it out, I know what you're saying, I know I'm not saying you're, in fact, some of you even listening to this or watching this, you've already gone here. Yeah, because my wife mentioned that. Yeah, I got some friends who were concerned about that. But, you know, I'm just trusting God with it. He's going to take care of me. The stories I could tell you about people who decided they were just going to trust God. So I know this is a little harsh, okay? So talk bad about me later at lunch or whatever. I really don't care. Let me tell you what you should trust God to do. And this won't make sense to some of you, but I'm going to tease this out later. Here's what you should trust God to do. You need to trust that God will not suspend the law of the harvest on your behalf. You should trust that God will not suspend the law of the harvest on your behalf. What do I mean by the law of the harvest? What am I talking about? This is so important. We're going to jump to the New Testament real quick because the Apostle Paul addresses directly the Christian inclination to misunderstand our Heavenly Father and use religious language as a cover or camouflage for irresponsibility. And so to do that, he sets up one of the most often quoted and ignored principles in the entire Bible, certainly the entire New Testament. Here's how he starts it off. Now remember, he's talking to Christians. So look up here a second. If you're not a religious person, you're not a faith person, or different, maybe a different faith tradition, and you're not a Christian, this verse isn't directed at you. But I think you should pay attention anyway. So he's writing to Christians, and here's what he says to Christians. He says, do not be deceived. There's an interesting little Greek word, planao, which means don't be confused. Don't allow yourself to be led astray. Don't look at these circumstances or these events and draw the wrong conclusion. Don't assume what other people assume about their indecision or their bad decisions and come to the same conclusions. In other words, don't be deceived. And the reason he says don't be deceived is because we are so easily deceived as it relates to what he's about to tell us. He says, do not be deceived. Then he doubles down. God cannot be mocked. In other words, if you think you are going to get away with something because you're so smart and so slick and so careful and so mature and so wealthy and so whatever it is, he says, you're crazy. You can't mock God. You can't write God off as irrelevant. You can't write God off as, hey, I know what Jesus said and I know Jesus is the Son of God, but I'm really smart, okay? I'm really careful. I really got my act together. I am so resourced. I know what it says, but the Apostle Paul shakes his head and says, do not be deceived. God cannot be dismissed. God cannot be mocked. He has set certain things in place, certain principles in place, universal equations. And if you ignore them, you pay. And a principle is different than a law. Just real quick, a law, you can break a law. You don't break a principle. You break yourself against a principle. Or you leverage a principle to your own good, but you don't break it. You can ignore it, but it's still operating in the background of your life. So what's he getting at? He's getting at people who think they will be the exception to this principle. He's talking to Christian people who think they can outsmart God. And here's what he says. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. Here it is. A man reaps what he sows. Only the men, women, you're on your own. You can do whatever you want to. There's no connection. No. You're thinking, I love the Bible. Now, in ancient literature, almost all ancient literature addresses men only. So Paul wasn't, you know, dissing the women. This is just the way they wrote. So essentially it means this. Do not be deceived, God cannot be mocked. People, all people, we reap what we sow. And you know this, you've warned other people of this, you've seen this, you've experienced this at some level. And the Apostle Paul says, yeah, but at some point we lose our minds and we deceive ourselves and talk ourselves into things and out of things and we think we can outsmart God and God's gonna suspend this principle on our behalf. Now, when my dad used to teach this, and he would teach us at home and he would preach this sermon, he would always say, in fact, I can't read this verse without hearing his voice saying, people reap what they sow later and greater, later and greater. Let's just say it together, later and greater. And later is why we're deceived. Mom, look, nothing's gonna happen. I did it. Hey guys, I appreciate it. Ladies, I appreciate you sitting me down and confronting me. But look, I've been involved in this for a year. I've been involved in this for 2 years and nothing's happened. Nothing bad has happened. Later, greater. So we get confused and deceived because of later, but you know what else? We're overcome and we're shocked over greater. Well, you know, if you've raised kids, you've told them life isn't fair. You're not kidding. Fairness ended in the Garden of Eden. Nothing has been fair ever since, okay? But here is where we get in trouble. Later and greater means the consequences and the benefits. It works both ways. The consequences and the benefits are always out of proportion to the input. I mean, the easiest way to understand this is the law of the harvest. Take any plant, consider the size of the seed, consider the size of the plant. There's no correlation. There's no equality. It is unfair. The seed is tiny. The plant is gigantic in relationship to the seed. It's the law of the harvest. So later and greater, and the greater is shocking. I don't deserve this. I didn't see this coming. There's no proportionality. Be warned. There's no proportionality. You should know this. Later and greater. In the language of the Proverbs, the writer of the Proverbs, we are fools. We are fools to assume otherwise. This is why I said, if you're gonna trust God, trust that God will not suspend the law of the harvest on your behalf. Irresponsibility has a consequence, later and greater. So back to Proverbs 27 for the grand finale. You ready for this? The prudency danger coming and they take refuge, but the simple keep going and suffer for it. Every single time. Some of you read the Message, the Bible version called the Message. It's a very modern version of the Bible. So I looked this up in there and this is what it says. He says, the prudency danger coming and take refuge, but the simple keep going and get clobbered. I love that. And they get clobbered. And you know why I like get clobbered? Because when you think about somebody getting clobbered, they're surprised. They're just going along, everything's great, and boom, right? And that's exactly what happens. They get clobbered. But when the simple keep going and ignore what's coming toward them, and they get clobbered, they're not the only ones that get clobbered, right? They're not the only ones that get clobbered. The people around them, the people that surround them, the people that care for them get clobbered as well, because their irresponsibility ends up on somebody's plate. Our irresponsibility, I know I've said it 100 times, always becomes somebody else's responsibility. Now, if you're under 30 years old, or let's just say if you're 30 years old and under, let me tell you what the people who are 50 years old and older are thinking right now. They're thinking, did they take reservations at Super Rica? No, by the way, they don't. No, that's not what they're thinking. What they're really thinking is this: wow, I wish I'd heard this when I was younger. What they should be thinking is this: I heard this when I was younger, but I didn't listen to it when I was younger. And you, some of you, have the opportunity to hear it and listen to it while you're younger, because there are relationships, too much time, too much irresponsibility, that you can't play catch up with. It's hard to play catch up financially. It's hard to play catch up physically with your health. It's hard to play catch up spiritually. And do you know why? You know why? Because all these things are governed by the law of the harvest, not the law of the final exam. You can cram for a final exam and pull it off and make an A. You cannot cram in the areas of life that matter the most to you. Relationally, financially, your health, your relationship with God, in terms of the time it takes to develop that kind of faith. In the areas that matter most, isn't it true? Small deposits over time make all the difference. Small deposits over time make all the difference. And you can't go back and reclaim the time to make the small deposits. So, are you ready to stop making excuses? Are you ready to start doing now? Are you ready to start doing now what you should have been doing all along? Are you ready to join this epic group of superheroes that we've called the responsibles? If not, if you're like, Andy, I can't argue with you. You have a microphone on. I'm sitting here in a crowd and I'm watching online. I can't argue but if you're sitting here and you're like, you know what? Okay, Andy, you're not all wrong, but I do got this and I can handle this. And yeah, I think God is gonna take care of me and I think it's all gonna work out and I do have time. Here's all I would say to you, okay? If you're not ready to take this step I'm recommending, tell the people you will be counting on what you will expect from them when you eventually reap what you are currently sowing. You should tell them. You should call them. You should get them together and say, hey, you know, the other day you warned me about, and I said, don't worry about it. I just want you to know, I still think I don't need to worry about it. But if what you think is gonna happen happens, I just want you to know, guys, I'm coming to you for help. And I'm gonna need you to maybe pay some bills. Mom, Dad, I'm gonna expect you to help me raise this baby. If what you think could happen happens, yeah, I don't know how I'm gonna pay for that. I don't know what's gonna happen in my career. You should just tell them that when you eventually reap what you're currently sowing, they should know what you'll expect. Look up here. And if you're afraid to do that, you need to think about that. And if you're not willing to do that, you need to think about that. Because if the roles were reversed and suddenly somebody came to you and expected you to pick up their slack when they didn't take your advice, how would you feel about that? Isn't this just the wise thing to do? Isn't this what people who connect the dots do? And maybe if you'll force yourself to do that, that one step of responsibility may lead to a second step of responsibility where you take responsibility for your life. Now, if you're not a Jesus follower, Just want to be clear, I have no authority to tell you what to do. I'm just making suggestions. This is just good advice or good counsel, or at least I think it is. But if you're a Jesus follower, I'll just be blunt. Irresponsibility is a sin. And here's why I say that. Because Jesus, he was so clear. Just follow him through the Gospels. And here's what you discover about Jesus and sin. Jesus would say, if it hurts him, that's a sin, whether it's on a list or not. If it hurts her, it's a sin, whether it's on a list or not. If it hurts you, it's a sin, whether it's on a list of sins or not, because God cares about you. And if your irresponsibility steals from other people, steals their time, steals their resources, steals their future, steals their retirement, steals their plans, if your irresponsibility steals from them eventually, of course your Heavenly Father, who loves you and loves them, would say, yeah, it's a sin. It creates a burden for someone. It creates a burden for you. And Jesus followers, we're burden carriers, like our King, not burden creators. So, again, don't plan to be a burden. Are you planning to be a burden by ignoring your health, ignoring your finances, ignoring what's becoming more of a pathway than a point of entertainment? Don't plan to be a burden. Plan. Be intentional. Be proactive to be a blessing to the people you love the most, the people you would turn to if things go off the rails. Take responsibility for your future. It's what love does. It's what Jesus followers do. And one other thing that Jesus followers do, they never, ever miss the final installment of a sermon series, ever. So don't miss part four of The Responsibles. Look at y'all.